right, guys. What's going on? I am the one, the only, the W-O-O-K-I-E. Joined by my lovely cast of chicken parms.
Delish.
Delish. We got Drazcar, the smoke show.
Yo, what's going, guys?
We got Mr. Ewok Jr.
Hello, Keyforge community. Great to
and
be here.
And Sheep.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's so excited. We're talking about my favorite thing today. My favorite thing is Ember Control. I love it. It's such a diluted number. It used to just mean one thing. Now it means so much more. And every time I have a Saurian deck, I have to reevaluate. But before we get into all the fun stuff, I'm back into full screen mode, which is a horrible feeling, by the way, if nobody knew. But we got ABR. Drazcore, what's going on with the ABR?
Well, so if you're listening to this, as in like during the recording, you still have time to get in. There was a couple seats left to get the next group of folks in, right? Because we want to have an even number of folks, or enough folks for everyone to be on a team and not have teams have different amounts of folks. So if you're listening and you haven't gotten in yet, definitely recommend it. Grab one of those last seats or two. And it's going to be great. We're going to do the draft on Saturday. Again, after you guys have listened to this, if you're listening to the recording, you guys can just be confident that I've already drafted the best team in the whole league, I think, right?
If I join, will somebody draft me?
I mean, if they have to.
If they have. Am I like the last kid picked?
They have to.
They do have to.
Oh, they have to. I don't want to be the last kid picked, though.
But you don't know, right? So, I guess. That is the nice thing.
But I also don't want to be like the first one picked because that's like high expectations.
I don't know if you have to worry about that.
No. Thanks, Drazcore. keeping it 100 with me.
So people do look at, hey, what was your record last season? Right? I don't believe
I don't have a record last season.
Yeah.
Don't trust them. Don't trust the wiki. You can't throw them, man. So
the
don't
folks
trust them.
That are,
I will bring nine
you know,
Heart of the Forest.
Perfect record
decks.
Last season. They're going to get snatched up first. So, But we purposely do not publish the list because nobody wants to be the last kid picked in kickball, and we're trying to strike that middle ground, like something that real experienced players can enjoy and have fun with, but something that new players can come and join in. And
I think you totally should publish a list.
Have a lot of fun.
I think you should.
I have to say, I think ABR does a really really nice job at incorporating a group dynamic. So the social atmosphere for Keyforge, you're talking, you're building. Some groups have been better than others, but that's really more on the group dynamic. But I like that you're sharing decks, you're talking strategy, and it doesn't matter if you're picked first or last. You don't really know. And frankly, it just doesn't matter because you win or lose as a group. So I love that aspect.
Post stats. All right, Ewok, what do we got for Vault Keeper?
We have Vault Keeper, so if you have not been going ahead and practicing, you definitely want to keep in mind May 14th, 15th, and then the 21st will be the follow-up weekend. So great events, Joker. Thanks again for having some competitive Keyforge for us to look forward to play. And if you don't remember, it is DT for day one, and day two, that follow-up is going to be MM and Worlds Collide choice, striking one, playing the other. And as long as you're above 50% from both events, then you get to go ahead and qualify for that day three. And then it's play one of your three decks.
And then Sheep, what's up with Swindle? There's so many leagues going on right now. Swindle League.
Well, there is the previous Swindle League, which Dr. Drazray is in the finals of.
Yeah.
I hate that name so much.
It's the best name ever. What are you talking about?
I hate it so much.
It's the best.
And then there is the next Swindle is announced. And I don't have all the details sitting in front of me. Because I'm a fool.
Okay. Well, more to come for Swindle.
It's a format that I have no experience playing. But
what's
it's definitely worth going and looking into.
Do you know the format? No?
Yeah,
all right.
Not like that.
Yeah. KFP.
I will go ahead. Hold on 1 second. I want to definitely send a shout out to Karen. Go ahead.
Swindle Event 3 is going to be Moray.
Okay.
And which one is Moray again?
Moray is... it's going to be each player brings 3 decks, each of a different set. At the beginning of week 1, each captain will randomly be assigned to play Archon Reversal or Best of 1. From there, and each week after that, the variant will rotate. Archon player in week 1 moves to Reversal in week 2, and then
Adaptive. So you're bringing 3 decks, and then the person changes weekly.
And then, yes, each week you'll have to either play Adaptive, Reversal, or Archon with them, it looks like.
Mm.
And you're picking your opponent, which one they're playing, right? So your opponent's going to tell you, okay, looks like we're Reversal this week, so you give me that deck, and then, you know, you decide which deck you're giving them, right? And then, you know, for Archon, you're choosing what they're going to play, I think. I think that's how it's working.
Sounds adaptive, really adaptive. Complicated.
It's not that complicated. You're trying to find decks that you can go ahead and maximize the effectiveness because you know lots of repetitions, but also be able to exploit the weaknesses for. And I like that it's causing us to be able to think. So I was giving a shout out for Karen. Karen, thank you once again for the events that you're running. She's doing a phenomenal job doing a lot of the legwork behind for Swindle. XO73, Joe, I had a great conversation after, I think it was last Friday night, but ABR again, ABR, Vault Keeper, KFPL, Swindle, I mean, and Karen's even helped with KFPL. There's so many good leagues, but thank you to all the people behind the scenes who are making it so that we can still play Keyforge.
Obviously, we've been talking about KFPL Season 4. This is the one I want to get into. Kagi Adaptive, or is it Kage?
So it's Kagi. Which
Keyforge
stands for
as Garfield intended.
Yeah, and so that's the acronym. It's essentially an adaptive experience. It's being run on the Sanctimonious and Time Shapers kind of shared Discord board that's there. But that's where you want to go ahead and head over. And Kagi's been running for quite a while, so it doesn't get a ton of airtime from what is here. But honestly, there's a lot of work that goes into it. And just
so can you explain to me what that all means? I'm interested.
For Kagi?
Yeah. Does that mean like Library Access Nepseed is live again?
No, nope. That has nothing to do with intended.
Okay.
Just that Garfield likes adaptive, right? So it's an adaptive league.
Oh, that's it?
Yeah. Well, he likes, you know, like his opinion was you play any deck and then adaptive fixes
anything.
That was kind of the thought there, I think.
See, I thought we were going to get rid of, like, the locks, you know what I mean, where you could control the weak. I'm trying to think of... I'm drawing a blank, but we get rid of the must versus can't rule and all the other
stuff. Nobody knows what to do ever.
Yeah.
What, are you going to go back to, like, your opponent can pick not to use Biomatrix backup? Like, you know, just, I guess.
you just lose.
You just lose.
You just lose.
That's Archive. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. That's what I thought it was. That's kind of, just from reading it, what was it? Who's the lockout? I'm sorry. Sheep, who's the lockout?
Rusty? Rusty Guntus?
Yeah, Rusty and Guntus and Control the Weak. Remember how that was a thing, and then, like, that quickly got eroded? And then, like, you know, obviously, like, you got too much to protect, which should be uneroded. Stuff like that. So I thought maybe those would it would just go back to pure.
You mean bait and switch?
Bait and switch, yes, I do.
Yeah,
I
he's looking at bait and switch. Mm-hmm.
Yes, that is exactly what I meant.
Yeah, so what? This would be a shout-out to Fighting Walloon, who's putting on Kagi. This is actually League 4, so 4.0. And it starts with the quote, I often like picking a deck and trying to win with it rather than picking a deck with the best chance of winning. And that was from Richard Garfield. So that was the intention behind this. And it's an Archon Adaptive Best of 3 match. So
I was going to say, are you handed
round robins. They're round robins, 6 to 8 players, but you're picking in the deck.
Mm. All right. So today, anything else? Are we good? We can move into the A.
I would also go ahead and have a shout out to the Nordic Keyforge League that is, you know, not necessarily here for a ton of stateside players, but you're in Europe. I mean, we do have an international audience to be able to be aware of it. They've done a phenomenal job actually as a podcast. So one of the three kind of going on. So the Nordic Keyforge podcast, great set of guys. And it's
weird story. You know, they want to do a crossover with us.
But why not? Like,
I said yes. I didn't say no. Yeah. I was just like, yeah, absolutely.
And I had actually, just so you're aware, I had reached out a long time ago when we had done Keyforge Live. And so we've seen players around. You know, I've gotten to know a couple of them, but just some really good individuals. And they run the Nordic Keyforge League. They have a lot of fun. It's kind of a tiered system. And they actually just broke that apart from the tiered system, which was really neat, into kind of more groupings, players, and then allowing them everyone a chance to be able to play for the top spot now. So I think it's great. If you want to play Keyforge, you have many opportunities. Also, big shout out to TCO, still going rampant. So I'm trying to think of what was the day I came. Maybe it was last Saturday or Sunday. And it was the middle of the day because I was setting up for my KFPL game. And all of a sudden, there was like 30 games that were going. So it's 60 plus people playing. And I want to say this is a Wednesday or Thursday. So great job. It's great to see. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right. Moving into to A.
Oh, I got a quick shout out and then we'll go there.
All right. Yeah.
You're probably like, what the heck is this thing? So...
No, I read it. When I read it, I'm like, what in the, like, how do I even say that?
Yeah. I'm going to say it's Banan Per Mobile's DOK card filterer. What the heck is this thing? So it's a Chrome plugin. So this guy on the DOK Discord was like, hey, you know, I made a thing. Check it out. Let me know what you think. And basically, what it is, a Chrome plugin you install, and when you open a deck in DOK, so it's got to be an individual deck, not like a whole search of a ton of decks. Basically, it allows for you to, when you click on something like Ember, right? Ember Control, the little icon on the right, it highlights all of the cards that contribute A to your deck. So you can quickly scan and see like, oh, you know, all of my A is in Shadows, or nope, I got it nice and spread around, so I'm good there. Or, you know, hey, let me filter on creature control C, right? And you can click it on and off. You can see what is and isn't fitting each of the stats. And so it's a cool way to look at your deck and just quickly figure out what might include what's underneath those numbers, what might be good or bad about that deck underneath the numbers. So I thought it was a fun, cool little plugin that now I'm messing around with and seeing, seeing what it can help me figure out about my decks.
I'm totally sitting over here smiling at this Drazgor because it's such a simple idea. Like the stats are already there. So they're already attached with cards and it's essentially just highlighting them for you as a scanning tool, which is brilliant. And again, simple, easy piece, but it's extremely valuable to be able to scroll. I mean, I've gotten much better, and I think we all go ahead and look at our attributes and we're like, okay, we know key cards, we know where they're at, but at the same time, to visually be able to see it, that's all your visual learners. That's going to be a great little plugin. So awesome job.
All right, moving into AC. See what I did there?
Mm-hmm.
No? Okay. Moving into Ember Control, we're going to go through the different types of Ember Control. Ember Control is my favorite stat and used to be one of the biggest stats I used to look at. Now I've come to the realization that maybe that's not 100% correct. This stat used to be a lot less convoluted pre-Worlds Collide. Then with the introduction of Saurians, Ember Control became just as convoluted as every other stat. So...
So let's start with our definition. The definition coming from DOK, and again, Cheap, I believe you've said this last two sessions. These definitions are from old Coda, but I don't know if this has been updated. Amber control represents the amount of amber the deck can deny your opponent for forging keys. lost and stolen amber is counted as a 1-to-1 ratio, while captured amber and increased key cost is counted as a 2-to-1 ratio, as those can be reclaimed or avoided.
Mm. I don't think that's been updated. Because there are still some Saurian cards out there that they technically, like Ludo, I think gives you like some weird ember control number. I don't remember what it is.
Ludo count? You know, I didn't even check.
Yeah, Ludo is considered ember control. Weirdly enough.
Ludo's considered 2 on the score that's here. So what you have to realize is Keyforge is a racing game. In its heart, you want to be able to be the first to forge 3 keys cheaply, going ahead and costing 6 amber for each of them, each of the keys. However, all of the amber control is going to have a large impact. Ludo is there. I have a little side note for later, but let's run through what we found. Do you want to go ahead and list all the different general categories?
Sure. I'll hit on all the different categories, and then we can jump into them. So we've got lose, right? So losing the amber, steal, right? The classic. I think that's what Wookiee's going to tell us he loves, right?
Yeah.
Key cost increase. Then prevent forging. Get into that one. Capture, right? Or ember pinatas, right? Then there's a twist on it, right? Capture from your own side. From your opponent's own side. Prevention. We'll talk about that. It's all about payment. Right? These are all weird categories now. Destroying keys. And then there's, I guess, kind of a different dimension, scaling ember, which could in theory be of a number of these different categories, but we'll get into that one as well.
So. Kind of the holy grail in what everyone looks at and will be seeking. All right, so we start with lose. When you say lose, Amber, what is happening there, Sheep?
Lose, that means you lose the amber, which is just a straight loss, and it gets around all the prevent steal effects that are in the game. There are many effects that say prevent steal, like discombobulator, and having a lose just gets around all that.
I feel like this, whenever I do this, this is when Sheep proclaims, not my space dollars.
100%.
Every time.
You guys like to wink my space dollars. It's upsetting.
I do like yanking your space dollars. It is a favorite pastime of mine.
You were shouting quite obtrusively during Sealed. But I mean, I think that lose in its effect, yes, it can get away from things like discombobulator. But there's some real purpose and some significance behind it. It's, again, if it's a race, you're just dropping down. So key cards like Burn the Stockpile, Brabble, Infernus, Shatterstorm, Grok, Shaffles, and then they had Evil Chelonia in here. Now, it's a whole listing, but Burn the Stockpile, you're above 7, you're going to just drop 4. There you go. Lose it, move on. That can be pretty big if it's timed right. Brabble being creature that when it dies, depending on whose turn it dies in, you're going to go ahead and lose some amber. Infernus. Well, there's some utility here, but what's happening with everyone's favorite Infernus?
Well, it's like so many things wrapped into one, right? So you get the potential for a whole bunch of amber control because, right, you're purging 2 cards. So, yeah, you might be causing your opponent to lose 2 amber. Right, and by the ratio and the definition, that would be, if assuming that's still followed, that would be an ember control of 1. But, you know, if you've got, if either you or your opponent has a whole bunch of pips on one card, right, maybe you've got a fertility chant, right? That's the holy grail, right? To purge your opponent's fertility chant, get 4 ember out of there, then that's pretty awesome, right?
Now, death.
Yeah, Tognath, right? You know, there's a bunch of different ones with multiple amber, or even just like with enhancements. Sometimes you can get multiple amber on stuff. Now, certainly you can, and sometimes it's a good thing to purge cards without, pips on them. Maybe even purge your opponent's amber control, purge their Burn the Stockpile or something, right? which but you always have that option even if you're not using it in that way. So there's just so many reasons to love.
Well, Infernus is a value train,
mm-hmm.
right? Like you, number one, I think Ewok said it past 2 weeks. Flexibility, right? I can get some Ember control out of him. I can purge cards that I don't want to see from my deck,
which makes it more efficient,
right? Which makes it more efficient, and then I can purge problem cards for me that maybe I don't want to see again. So Infernus is just a value train.
Yeah, if I'm running a big giant board deck, oh, I just removed your C. Guess what? Now you don't have that. You were depending on it. You were counting on it. It's in your deck. Eh, too much of a problem. Amber Control, Drez, you already went ahead and talked about that. So, you know, if you have those key cards, I really like utility cards. I think Infernus is definitely there. I will say the next one, Shatterstorm. Ooh. It is a Mars beast, and I got a chance to face Erie Daily again with Mars and Shatterstorm. And when you have the ability to consistently cycle and every turn play that Shatterstorm against you, it's brutal. So Shatterstorm, if you're not familiar, is going to go ahead and we can play some good.
That's a third, right?
Shatterstorm? Yeah, it is a third.
I don't know who made that decision to make it a third. I can barely divide in half.
Oh.
Well, you multiply by three. It's easier.
Yeah, it's multiply by three. I don't feel that is...
Is that one hard for you, Wookie? It should have multiplied by two.
That's too many fingers
Shatterstorm,
and toes, sir.
Yeah. Shatterstorm is Mars action that says play, lose all your amber.
Oh, this isn't the one I was thinking of, but yes.
Then your opponent loses triple the amount of your amber you lost this way. So I think the key piece here is that you're forced to lose all of your amber right there. And that's what stops most individuals. But in the right decks, with the ability to go ahead and generate quite a bit for Mars, it does some wonders. And for a chance in the right deck to be able to actually pull some key cheat with MG, Martian Generosity, and Key Abduction. You don't need that amber as much as you would think. You can just play with cards. So Shatterstorm can do some wonders.
Oh, never mind. You need to put it on there. Yeah, no. I haven't seen Shatterstorm in a long time, actually, to be honest with you.
That's because it's in bad Coat of Mars decks.
Yeah,
which
sure,
you see in Reversal,
sure.
Which is real fun because you see it in Reversal, and then it just
everybody loses.
Go on forever.
Nobody wins. Everybody loses.
You say that, but the deck that I had to face for my league for Erie Daily, I faced previously when I was subbing in for Rickster, and I faced here in KFBL, and it said, what is it, a 91 SAS deck? It is not something to go ahead and close your eyes at. You have to know. And once that Mars house is set up, it's got two Mars firsts. It's got three proliferators. It has Martian Generosity. No Key Abduction there, but frankly, it doesn't need it. It just goes ahead and spits things out, and it is able to play that Shatterstorm turn after turn after turn. It gets you in a lock, and that's a way to be able to go ahead and say, yep, you're in this lock. You're not doing anything, so good luck. Goodbye.
What's the win condition then?
What's the win condition? Oh, yeah. It goes ahead... because it can actually generate more than six amber in a turn from its Mars seed.
Okay.
So I basically was able to withstand.
So it generates six, forges the key, then generates a couple amber, then Shatterstorms to basically have you lose all your.
Correct. Then you lost yours. And all it really needs to generate is two, and which is easy enough to be able to be there.
Right. Because that makes sense.
If you spit out, I mean, there's a harvester that's there. There's multiple Mars pieces. And as long as you're not throwing all three of the proliferators out, you just use the proliferator and the Mars first in order to cycle your Mars first proliferator and your and the Shatterstorm. The MG2.
It's a good card. Yeah, it is a good card. It is kind of a weird one in that it can be real good, but it can also
do nothing.
Contribute to just some terrible... reversal decks because you are sinking your own ember, right? You need it's good in a deck where you have ways to generate a whole bunch, forge, and then tank your opponent.
Is
but
Shatterstorm an AOA?
All right, now I gotta look.
I want to know because now I have an idea.
Yes,
it
Coda
is
an AOA. Yep.
I have an idea. It's not a good one, by the way. by any means. Well, actually, it's a very good one. Just I don't think anybody's gonna like it. It's another one of those of being as fully degenerate as possible. That's lose is lose. I don't know. Is lose a one to? Because okay, so it says on Dex of Keyforge loses a 1-to-1 ratio.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm fine with that. Steel
is also 1-to-1.
Is also 1-to-1, but I feel steel should be 1-to-2.
Well, you get for steel, you also get.
But I've created a 2 ember swing.
Right, so you get expected ember for steel as well as.
Oh, yeah, so that one for the steel goes into expected.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Ugh. What I also think is interesting, because a number of the cards that were added in, Bumpsy, Crump, Grenade Squib, Lomir, Flame Fist, Screech Bomb, all of those are Coda cards. And so you're looking, there's a little asterisk there with Coda Brabnar. But think about with this information, the definition coming out from Coda and not really being changed, how much those cards you'll still see. I think they're very valuable.
Yeah.
But if you're not playing Coda, it's not a major stat anymore. It's not a major impact.
I'd like to see it come back. I definitely would. I'd like to see Lewis come back.
Yeah, I did like Coda Brabnar. You know, I think, I think as I was just scrolling through, this is a little bit why, right? There was all these different cards that could just ping away your opponent's ember and try
right.
to keep
Coda
you
Coda Brabnar was very focused. Well, I don't want to say focused, but Coda Brabnar had more lose than anything,
definitely.
Right? So
definitely,
Brabnar had a purpose in Coda where, you know, trying to think, I can't remember the deck. I've borrowed it to Ewok before, but that had, you know, it had a couple Bumpsies. It had the other one. Well, Bumpsies play, and then your opponent loses one, and then I'm forgetting the other guy who is like fight, and your opponent loses one.
Grok.
It had one of those in there. It had a Screech Bomb in there. You know, like there was Ember Control in the house, and it was possible to whittle it away. Down with the Brabnar house.
It was probably Crump, actually, if it was Coda.
But, maybe it was Crump. Yeah. I can't.
Yeah.
Well, Grok didn't come out to World's Collide, right? No, maybe he came out in AOA.
He was AOA, I think.
Yeah. Either way, we should move into Steel, because lose is, some of these are pretty straightforward. Lose is lose, you know. It's okay, but it's not Steel.
Are you talking about Sir N. Bear Blossom?
Yes, that's the one, Bear Blossom.
I know. It's your favorite from the day.
Bear Blossom was my favorite, and then I still have the one. I still have it in the box that, what's his name, gave to me in, I'm trying to think, like I'm drawing a blank on names today for some reason, but he made us Archon's Corner boxes, little
that's
deck
cool.
boxes, and I still have, I have Bear Blossom in one, and I have the old school. I'm still waiting for when library access gets unmodified. Because I'm ready. I'm ready.
You're just waiting for all cards to get unerratted. I don't know. I don't know.
The memory will slip and he'll forget Lokakar and others.
I will.
He'll probably forget me and Sheep.
I'll forget
pretty
that.
Soon.
Dude, you know what? This is a problem for me because there's a lot of the times where I'm like, I can't remember anything today. And it's a big problem for me. I have those days where I'm just, you know, listen, right now, as of time of recording, it's the 31st, right? If you were in retail, you know that was one thing. It's the end of the month. And that means you are scrounging to get all your numbers together in that final push for the end of the month. And I'll tell you what, we're having a contest right now, and one store was beating me. And me and my DM are just scrounging any way we can figure out to get that to get us above that other store. Hopefully we'll win.
You cut I'll their you power know. Lines.
Well, I mean, they're in Minnesota, so that's going to be a big drive. But all right, let's move into next. Steel. My favorite. The only Ember Control worth having.
Steel. Why do you love it so much, sir?
Because it's, again, I think, well, like you said, it goes into that expected ember, but it's a two, anytime you steal one ember, that's a two ember swing. You have taken one of theirs, so you have put them behind, and you have gotten yourself ahead. I love things like Relentless Whispers. Love that card. I get an ember, and I take one of yours, and then I put it by me. such a great card. Relentless Whispers, fantastic card. Ronnie, I think Ronnie is... Ronnie might still be one of the top five cards in the game.
It's really good.
I mean, when we're talking, like, cards you just love to see and are just effective no matter what, period, end of story. Like, I think you've got Infernus on there. You've got Control the Weak, which I think now you can kind of like say like Control the Weak. And what's the new version of Control the Weak that came from MM?
The Mark of Dis.
Mark of Dis. Like that's the same card, really, right? Like more or less, it's the same card. And
that's
then,
similar, right? They're growing up to the same thing, yeah.
Right, and then like I'm sorry, Ronnie Wristlocks, just bare minimum top 10 card. I think we should do that. We should get a top 10 card list of all the cards.
For everything.
Over the whole shebang. All five sets. Mm-hmm. All six sets, I'm sorry, right? Mm-hmm. And just what are the best cards? Because I think Ronnie is going to be on there. And you got routine job. Like, I mean, two routine jobs is good, but you want that four routine job.
So are you talking an individual card by itself, or are you talking in tandem? Because
it can't be like, if I have this card, this card's great.
Like, well, but you're no saying matter what job you want four, one right. of them, eh, who cares?
Well, you'll never get just one. You'll always get a pair.
All right. Well, we're going to refocus you, my friend.
Refocus
on
to
steel.
Me. We're going back to steel. Get your lists ready. Keyforge bingo. Here we go. But JR, what do we got in steel? Tell me about my favorite stat.
Well, your favorite stat. You're all about Eon the Fringes, Schuler, Scrivener Favian, Urchin. You're all about urchins. Bow Nithings
urchin.
For MM.
Sea urchin.
Relentless Whispers. So some nice actions there. Ronnie Swindle, routine job, and Bait and Switch. And even before we're casting, Wookiee is still trying to go ahead and make an argument that Bait and Switch should be
100% should be unerotted.
Unerotted. You're on unerotted. A real unerotted kick.
I think we should go back to basics. I think we should unerotted. See, I often wonder, like, if we unerotted a lot of these cards that are eroded, like, does it affect with the speed of the game right now and how fast mass mutation is, like, if we unerotted it, would it even matter? Would it even affect it? We could talk about that in a different show. We're talking about steel right now. Keep going.
And then the last one that was there was our fiends coming from MM when the destroyed effects. So they're destroyed. They get cycled back. I did not see. Oh, my goodness. I don't know how we missed it.
So many, though.
There is, but what is our shadows that you should see in MM that you're cycling back? That is your Red Penny. So, I mean, that was the big one that I would see there.
Yeah, I mean, there's all sorts of, like, you know, if you go back to the original Coda, right, there's, like, Dodger and Naughty, and, like, there's so many, right?
Well, but I think this is one of those pieces, the ability to quickly play, so an action, you're going to most likely get that off. The ability for a creature to be able to be reused, and we see that more in the next area. I guess if you keep the fringes there, you get some utility. But for the most part, that just kind of dies. But just the chance for... I would much rather have a Ronnie or a Bow or an Urchin than I would to have an Umbra. What do you guys think? Would you prefer to have that creature or...
Nah.
No, you want...
I want it right away.
Especially,
right.
You want the immediate effect, especially for Ember Control, right? Because
Ember so
Control
fragile.
Is very timing-based, right? Stealing, or really any of these, well, especially when we get to, like, Key Crossed Increase, right? But it's so much more effective when your opponent has a lot of Ember, right? If your opponent has zero Ember, stealing does diddly-squat, right? But if they have a whole bunch of Ember... then you want to do it now, right? You don't want to play your Dodger or your Umbra and then maybe next turn, but probably not because you probably won't call Shadows again for a while. Maybe you'll get to steal, right? That's not that great, right? You really want to say, hey, I want to call Shadows or whatever house because I want to stop my opponent from forging now and maybe get myself into a forge position, and suddenly the tables have turned. Right, so you need immediate actions, and you need on-play effects for creatures.
The thing about creatures and their creature control, I don't know what Umbra actually... I don't know if somebody has a deck in DOK readily available that has an Umbra in it. But like the thing about Umbra, it just, again, it has to survive.
Yep.
Which is which a lot of the times is a real bummer, right? Because you're like, oh, I got the Ember. No, I don't. And I got the Ember control, and it's gone. It reminds me of that like South Park episode. We're gonna sort of move some stocks over here, shuffle some stuff over here, and it's gone. That's Umbra because he's gonna die before you get back to him.
Yeah, so Umbra is a Shadows 2-power elf thief creature, skirmish, and then fight, steal one.
Okay, so I just found him. He only gives you 0.74 in Umbra control, which, if you ask me, is far too high.
Well, the Umbra control can range from half a so 5/10 to one whole.
Yeah, which is still too high. Like this is one of those things. Like when we talk about Ember control, this is what you have to look for, right? Like Umbra is not hard. What am I looking for? Like he's not hardcore Ember control.
He's not guaranteed.
He's not a guaranteed Ember control. Charette, which is a guaranteed 3 Ember on Charette, which is going to delay them a turn, or even like a Mermook. Right, which increase the key costs. That's going to happen. Like you're better off. I'm just trying to think. Who was the 5-power? Was it Schuler? No, that seems wrong. The 5-power. Yeah, 5-power. You know, fight, steal one.
No, that's Dodger.
Dodger.
So even he was a little more reliable, but still at 5. You know. Maybe not. I might get something. Might not.
Well, I think the main piece here is that in order for a creature to stand out, there's a lot of creature control. We had gone through that last week. But you're actually looking at having to come back to a house. And with 3 houses, a play effect is a lot more valuable than going ahead and having to call a house twice in a row to get any use out of it.
So you hear that, Aaron?
Hey,
from FFG, make more on-play effects. It's the only ones that matter.
No way. We want more World's Glide Brobnar.
No, stop that.
All right. Hey, sheep. Got a question for you. Would you rather have an Umbra or a Bat Drone, and why?
Bat Drone.
Hmm.
Because it's in a house with less Amber control.
And I think
effectively the same, except for that.
But I would actually go ahead and put Bat Drone is more viable as a use, in my opinion, because the sets that it's in, I am more likely to come back to that house with creatures in it.
Logos repeat in AOA or Coda?
They're not good. But I'm going to tell you that with Mothers or some other pieces, it comes back.
All right, Mothers reap if they live, so that's fine. But Umbras, yeah, I mean, like, they're a crapshoot apiece to me. But I just tend to say Bat Drone because it could take the spot of that guy with the D name, and he's really bad.
Dexter.
Dexter?
Yeah. Getting any more Dexters is sad, or I'd take him. I don't know. I wonder. I'm just him or Quixo.
Quixo.
Dexter or Quixo?
Depends.
No. Bat Drone or Quixo.
Oh, Bat Drone or Quixo. Yeah. I was like, I'm definitely taking Quixo. Is that even a question? What kind of question are you asking here?
I do think that actually seeing Amber control in Logos, which has very, very little, that is valuable. What you have to keep in mind is you can only steal how much Amber your opponent has. So if you're actually playing a really heavy steal deck, there is a piece for building up a giant board, making, you know, depending on what they have for creature control, but building up the board and then being able to reap it out again and again and again. That is a viable strategy that I've seen. And with shadows, if you are looking at an Umbra or you're looking at a Dodger, there's only so much that you can steal, and there's frankly a lot of other actions that you're going to be using.
There's always space dollars.
Yes, you can reap.
There's always space dollars to steal.
Yeah,
always.
I don't know. I think that what FFG did do a nice job with is actually to incorporate steal hate later on, and so you see that through cards like Discombobulator, Gargantodon, Oduak, Red Hand Registry, and Vault Keeper. I know Vault Keeper was there from the beginning. It's too easy to be able to kill an individual creature.
They didn't make the creature big enough. Who is it? What is the one? It's not Oduak. He's a six car. What's the one I'm thinking of?
Oduak's five.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oduak's five.
You're saying Vault Keeper. Vault Keeper was there from Coda.
No, he was there. I'm saying that their mistake with Vault Keeper is they didn't make him big enough. Who's the 16 power dinosaur?
Yeah, so Vault Keeper, for anyone following along at home, is a sanctum creature, 4 power, 1 armor, spirit knights. Your amber cannot be stolen.
Now, sometimes I've wondered, right, because Vault Keeper is a rare. And
it came up as a rare, correct.
Yeah, Steel was king, and I didn't really see Vault Keeper decks running around that much, right?
Well, you got to remember, Sanctum was pretty garbage.
Sure.
In Coda.
But what if it was uncommon? Like, sometimes I wonder if they had just made it uncommon, would that have changed the meta? Would there have been enough folks with, hey, I've got a, you know, got a double Vault Keeper deck and I've got some,
I think he was too small. He was too small.
I think 4 power, 1 armor was fine. I think that you needed to actually put it in the common field. I know that we need to see our common, more powerful. Wow. Yeah. And I think that in the common slot, because if you're looking at Sanctum, it has capture there and it would have been a disruptive piece. But outside of that, Sanctum from Coda just did not offer enough to be super competitive.
Well, there's never been, I don't think, right? A common. Or wait, Oduak is common. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I guess so Oduak is common.
That's why World's Collide came in.
Gigantosaurus? Yeah. Is that the 16 power creature it says you're
Gargantodon.
Gargantodon. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
Where just your ember cannot be stolen. I mean, and it's 16 power. Like, that, I think that was the real, real big, like,
it's not
just missed
your
that.
Amber can't be stolen. It's your stolen amber becomes captured amber.
Oh, instead. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Either way.
Totally should make a Gigantosaurus, though, Wookiee. I agree.
Gigantosaurus, yeah. But
yeah, they should make that.
And then a Redonkosaurus, and
now we're talking.
But let's move into key cost increase.
Well, hold on. Before you get off that, I think that the important piece for Gargantodon, okay, so 16 power, beast, Saurian. Gargantodon enters play stunned. Gargantodon only deals 4/1 fighting. Fine. But looking at the next piece, which is the key piece you're looking at, each amber that would be stolen is captured by a creature controlled by the active player instead. This is a symmetrical piece. So do not go ahead and miss that. Now, typically you have Saurian, so you're not terribly worried. But I have seen a couple people try and go ahead and capture steel, and it's going to go ahead and, you know, that steel is going to be captured if Gargantodon is out.
Kickoss increase.
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of an evil. I'm looking at evil eye. This is kind of an interesting one. I do like me some key cost increase. Number of them in here. Garcia, Lash of Broken Dreams, Edai. All very, very, very good. Proc, you don't see it. Was Proc a rare? Proclamation 346E? Yeah. Redder Gallum, another good one. Quadricorder, probably one of the best increased cards. Well, maybe not. He's probably behind Edai. Edai 4x4 was just... That card is so busted. You guys complain about the busted cards. I want to Unarada. Edai is a busted card. let me go ahead and archive a card and make your key cost +1 for each card archived. That's not a busted card, but we're complaining
about
Fate and Switch. One
of them isn't busted, but you know, if you got a whole ton of them and recurring, now you're in business.
Well, I mean, I guess one of them can. One of them's not very busted, but just the amount of archiving in Worlds Collide, which is where Edai came out, and even into Mass Mutation, the amount you were able to do, like, that made Edai pretty busted.
Well, again, you're looking at utility, archiving a card, increasing key costs. You can do it to make them pay. Again, it's the race. But why is Edai valuable? It's in the common slot. Think if Edai was in an uncommon slot or a rare slot, you wouldn't have that same argument.
Yeah,
but it becomes powerful because of the common. Yeah. So we really do, if you want the next set to take off and to really have meaning, throw your power cards into that common slot and allow it to be in most of your decks. And lots of people love it when they're playing sealed with it or when you're playing, you know, for your Archon.
I mean, I think what was Nathan's deck at the Worlds Collide sealed? Was it a triple Edai deck?
Well,
it was triple Edai, right?
Well, one of the things that makes Edai so good is he's in a set that has both TMTP and Intranential Graft.
Mm-hmm.
IG.
Grump
Scaling.
Buggy. Grump Buggy was a card that never actually, I mean, Grump Buggy did have a thing, but I feel like Grump Buggy never really took off.
Just
maybe because it's an AOA.
Grump Buggy.
It was an AOA period card, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
I don't think it's in any other set. It's not. Yeah, it was AOA period.
It's not as, now that there's things that are bigger than Bromnar, it's no longer useful.
Well, but that's the whole piece. As soon as Worlds Collide came out, you now have dinos that become bigger, and so Grump Buggy becomes essentially a toss card. It doesn't become valuable unless it's in the right matchup. And, you know, any two decks, you can have an advantage there. But looking at later sets, Grump Buggy was kind of sidelined. I think Pismire is a really nice card, highlighting the mutant trait. And being able to increase the key costs. I actually like cards like Edai or Pismire where you can have multiples and, you know, have that impact.
Edai is just above and beyond good. Like, Edai is good. He's just a good card. He's got that flexibility. Pismire, if you are facing an opponent who is offset, you're all set. If you are facing an opponent who's onset,
yeah, I mean, I still like it. I like it quite a bit. It's untamed, right? Ember Control and Untamed, and which there's not a lot of. And, right, you are in the driver's seat, right? You can say, ooh, they do have, you know, another mutant in May, so let me knock out a couple guys, and suddenly I'm in good shape, right? So you can make it work.
He fires if you have more mutants, but it's not the other way around, right?
Yeah, no, it's all upside for you, right? Hey, play a couple more mutants on your turn, and now you're in business, right? So, I like him quite a bit.
Yeah. Prevent Forging. This is one of the things that I see, like, one of the, like, there's not much here. Miasma Bomb. Key Forgery, Key Imps. I don't know if I can. Well, I guess they do prevent forging.
Forge your first, second, or third key.
Yeah,
gold.
Yeah. They prevent happiness, too.
It was such a great idea and concept, but just like never came out functionality-wise. Right. Cease Forge, HOTF, Heart of the Forest. Love that card. So what we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We only have 8 cards that prevent forging in the game. Really?
The 3.
Well, I'm counting.
Yeah, not that many.
Yeah.
Are we missing? We're probably missing one somewhere, but
I don't think so. I actually really don't think so.
Yeah.
Like, again, Miasma, probably still the greatest of all these cards. Miasma Bomb's a little too slow, can be destroyed. The Imps just don't function. Like, maybe they do, but there's a really good chance they just
don't. Need a key cheat, and, like, the problem is, like, you get them in a sealed deck, and if you don't have a key cheat, especially, like, the gold key imp, like, if you play it, like, basically you just lock the game down, right? Because your opponent can't kill it on their turn, because then they'll give the game to you, and you can't kill it on your turn, you'll give it to them. So, like, I just don't like them because of the sealed situation. I'm okay.
I like the idea of the imps. They never function.
Yeah, bronze or silver's okay, I guess, but like the gold one just bothers me. I don't like that card at all.
So that's one of the pieces for game design that you want to look at. Locking out from first or second key is significantly better because it's not locking out the game. I do think that the game design, they actually did a very nice job by bringing in Seaforge. So Seaforge, Star Alliance, Artifact Law, play put two time counters on Seaforge. Players cannot forge keys. At the start of your turn, remove a time counter from Seaforge, then destroy it if there are no time counters on it. I think this is a real evolution from Heart of the Forest and the Imps for that third lock, because there is a time piece, and it actually gives the advantage to the person who is playing Seaforge.
I'm not a huge fan of Seaforge, just because like you got to play it at the right time. If you don't play it at the right time, I mean, I guess at least you get a number for it.
That's the whole piece. It's a rare, and if you don't go ahead and play it at the right time, then it's not going to lock up the game.
Right.
It can be really strong, though.
Mm-hmm. It can be. No, it 100% can be. But it also can 100% also just be a dead card.
I don't know about you guys.
It's so strong. Like, because even if you've got Amber control, right? Or artifact control, right? So they can still stall for one turn, even if you've got that hard removal, right? I guess if they have borrow, now you've given your opponent the advantage. But even with hard artifact control, you play it out. Hey, your opponent didn't win on the beginning of their turn, and in order to key cheat, they've got to both, right? Because it's not like Miasma, right? They've got to both destroy Seaforge and key cheat. So then even if they're able to kill Seaforge, they're still often giving you the opportunity to win on your next turn, even if you don't get the two full turns. It's really good. It's a real strong card.
I agree with you. It's fun. And can come in handy. I don't know. Like I'm not hard looking for any Seaforge decks. You know,
how many have we run into in competitive play?
Seaforge?
Yeah, they're not just running around. I mean, I just did a quick little DOK search, and I mean, you have a couple decks that are up there, but you just don't see them. So it's not something that you need to worry about, because you need to have other cards, 35 other cards that are going to go ahead and deal with it, you know, complement it, be able to make a good solid deck, and it's coming in DT. I mean, there's a lot of different pieces, but I think we worry when it's not really a big concern.
No, it's not. All right, Captured Ember, the worst kind of Ember. Bleh. I hate it. Dan loves Captured Ember. Dan, tell me about your Ember Pinatas.
Captured Ember, right? Like, it just sits on a creature until they kill it. It's gotten better since Coda, but it's still not good.
I mean, that about sums it up.
Way better.
I mean, I'll tell you, Anthony is probably the best, right?
I don't know. I mean, Anthony's big, but he leaks. He's leaky.
Well, he's leaky. That's fine, but it's only one at a time.
I don't know. Yeah. I think that Worlds Collide was the perfect spot for Captured Amber. And it's because of the other cards that supplement or protect it. Otherwise, they are just simply Amber Pinatas. They're waiting for you to be able to go ahead and blow up. There's some synergy when you're playing Shadows, and you know, you have some big TMTP to go ahead and set it up. But for the most part, you want to put that Amber out and then say, come and do something with it. So you're looking for Tribute Six Emperor. You're looking for, you know, Exile after tributing. You're looking for being able to use it with Glorifine Ideal. Even Brachus or Imperial Forge. I think the other piece that's often missed from Worlds Collide is just the ability to ward it. Ward that or Ludo fight with it as soon as possible if you have a Ludo that's out there to be able to kill it off. Those are things that are important because then it essentially becomes not captured amber, but it becomes a lost amber for your opponent.
So good.
Yeah, all I think I always, from time to time, I would look at decks and be like, oh, well, maybe this will be okay because I'll see I have a TMTP or something. All right, I'm going to capture all their ember, and then I'm going to wait, and then I'm going to kill all my guys, and then they're going to have a million ember, and then I'm going to capture all but six, and I'm going to win.
How's that working out for you?
Well, I mean, there are decks that could do that well, but I feel like they're kind of few and far between, mm-hmm. right? There's not a lot of good ways to wipe out your entire board in Shadows, for example, right? If you want to play that TMTP, right? Poison Wave? I mean, how many guys are you killing with that, right? Like maybe a bunch, but what are you capturing with, right? You're in Coda, right? You're capturing with your Sanctum armored dudes, right? So that doesn't really work too well. I guess if you have a Drumble, right? That could be good, but overall it's a little tricky, right? Graft with logos to some extent, right? But again, you're probably setting up for multiple turns to make this all work. And any setup that's going to take multiple turns, where you got to call multiple houses in the right order, you know, a good opponent is going to be able to take advantage of that, and it can be hard to pull off. Which is why, in some ways, you know, Worlds Collide Saurians are good, because they can do some of these silly things in a single turn.
Not only can, they will be doing silly mm-hmm. things in a single turn.
Yep. Tribute, City State, Senator Brackus, Imperial Forge, Exile.
Yep.
Right, like, oh my gosh.
And is that game? Yeah. Whirlpool. Oh, good game. Yeah.
Whirlpool is new with...
Right. Capture.
Capture. Sorry, I actually just finished my Swindle match, so I was highly distracted there.
Did you win?
Really? All you guys, I did win.
Yay for Dr. Drasray!
Oh my god, that name's so bad. So bad.
So good.
So good. All right, best. Capture from your own sides. This is another one where we don't see a ton of it.
Nope.
We are missing one card, and I can't remember the name of it, unfortunately. On our list, Capture from Your Own Side, Martin Sneed's Ember, Hypnotic Command, Mind Warper, Scooped. There is another one that is like Hypnotic Command, but significantly worse. Because Hypnotic Command, you capture one, your opponent captures one from their own side for each Mars creature you have. There was another mm-hmm. one that was capture one. Oh, maybe it wasn't. Maybe it was just steal one. Maybe it was like steal one from your opponent for each ready Mars creature.
Oh, the yes, that was the psychic.
I'm drawing a blank
circle
on what it is.
That's wrong. It's like there's like a circle of Mars dudes. Like
yeah, yeah. It's
stuff.
Like three Mars dudes in a circle and holding hands.
So it's Psychic Network.
That's
which
the
is
one.
A Mars
Thank you.
Action play. Steal one for each friendly ready Mars creature. Yeah. So you have to have Mars creatures out. They have to be ready, and then you steal for each friendly.
Yes, that's the one. But Hypnotic Command, so good.
Yeah, I don't get why there's like tiers of quality there. The one that they have to be ready versus you just have to have creatures down and just the total...
Because FFG did not want you to play Mars and Coda.
That's
how it went. Just like they didn't want you to play Brobnar and Worlds Collide. I don't know.
Mars needs Amber. Each damaged enemy non-Mars creature captures one from their own side. So you're capturing from your own side, but you have to be damaged. So that's the stipulation that's on here versus the stipulation of having ready Mars. They're both stipulations. It's odd that they're forcing Mars to be able to have these stipulations where, frankly, Shadows doesn't, but...
I remember at one time when we thought it was going to be Mars needs Ember Phosphorus... No, it wasn't one of the Phosphorus Stars. What was it? The one where you
Ammonia
don't...
Clouds?
No, Ammonia Clouds was in Coda. Maybe it was Phosphorus Stars? The one deal four damage to each enemy creature if you control.
Flaxum.
We thought that was going to be a pretty sweet combo. Never panned out.
I have seen decks that can do it, but they are pretty few and far between. Actually, I feel like I've played against some of those weird decks in like adaptive situations where it's like, wait, do I want to kill my own guys or do I not want to kill my own guys?
Kill them all.
It's like, it's like tricky.
I actually, I'm of the thought where we should just play cards and actually never have creatures on the board. I love those days in Coda where you just didn't have to worry about the board. Oh my goodness, those were good. It was just play cards, win game. Oh, so good.
Actually, one of the recent KFPL games, I had a really sweet play that I chose to take and blow up my own side of the board. There was, I think, one or two creatures at that point, but he had just gone ahead and he had Golden Spiral and Cincy out. And so it was going to be a matter of lights out because of the ability to keep playing and cycling. And that's exactly what you do. You break your board, you destroy it, and Cincy then went away. So there are definitely reasons why you want to blow up your own board. It very rarely happens for a one-sided board wipe on your own side, but there are choices.
There certainly are.
Gas Pipes Malone, by the way. Just pull that out.
Tell me about Gas Pipe Malone.
I mean, he does the same thing. Opponent captures from outside whoever he fights. It's okay.
So, prevention.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's talk about prevention.
Because, I mean, why take away your opponent's Ember or stop them from forging when you just prevent it from getting it in the first place, right?
Now, Master of Gray is prevention. Master of Gray was so good against MM.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, those pips, poof. Don't matter.
Yep. But your critters can still reap.
They can.
Critters
unless
be running wild. Unless you have Barrister Joya. What does Barrister Joya say?
Opponent's creatures cannot reap.
There's a bunch of these. I don't know why everyone likes Joya. There was so much. I guess just can't reap.
Yeah, and well, it's 5-power, 1-armor, right? Yeah. She's also hard to kill, right? So, and there's, I don't think there's any other cards that are that reap hate-y. Like, there are...
Oh, did you even play AOA, bro?
Well, there's stun. Right. Yeah, there's, which is different.
That was so much, right? There was so much reap hate in AOA, it was like they would never wanted the game to finish.
Well, yeah. Inky Gloom, Opposition Research, and Dry the River are all pretty it's heavy repaid cards.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then that dinosaur, or no, Shadowsaurus? No. What am I thinking? Necrosaurus. Necrosaurus.
Yeah, if you go out.
Oh, right.
Something.
All right, we didn't pull this category together so well.
No. No. Because, I mean, there's so many cards in AOA that's repate, prevention.
I actually lost the other night because of a freaking Orb of Invidious.
Oh, gosh. So I think of that as creature control, but I don't know. Is it Ember control? Is it prevention? Maybe?
Orb?
Yeah.
Explain, Dan.
It says after a creature reaps, stun it. So then, like, my Ember control was all reap-based Ember control.
So you couldn't control their Ember.
I could control it one turn, but not the next turn.
Yeah, so it's repate for sure.
But repate is definitely prevents Amber generation because the rest of my creatures were stunned from the previous turn. So like I get to unstun them, and I don't make any Amber, and I lost the freaking game.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
That makes me very sad.
You seem upset about this.
Like this is actually the repate cards from AOA have gotten consistently better. Like, that's part of why AOA was considered so bad against Coda, is top-end Coda didn't need to reap, right? So all these repate cards were just, like, dumb. And then kind of the same thing in AOA, not quite to the extent, but, like, Repate and AOA, I don't know. It wasn't good enough to compete, so Repate never got its spot. But now, AOA decks, Wreckface on Star Alliance decks, and all these decks that just want to call the same house again and again. So, it's definitely a thing.
Are you trying to make a case for AOA again?
AOA best set.
You do that often. You do that
so,
often.
So, Nero, by the way, Nerotaurus. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so Inky Gloom and these cards, these did not show up in my, hey, we're going to start recording on a podcast in the next 10 minutes. Maybe I'll do a little bit of research. because they are not listed as having Ember Control on DOK. Inky Gloom is 0.5 creature control, right? So opposition research is going to be the same thing. The way that DOK calcs it, they don't even consider it Ember Control.
What's interesting is Nerotaurus, so 6 power Saurian Dinosaur Politician creature. So fight, enemy creatures cannot reap during your opponent's next turn. Reap, enemy creatures cannot fight during your opponent's next turn. It does present an issue if you get it out, but it's one card. It's only worth 2,500, so quarter of a point.
Yeah, it's and it can be quite good, right? This was actually one of the cards I had in the sealed deck that I played at KeyForge Live, and that ability at the right moment to prevent my opponents from reaping, that definitely saved me a couple games and won me out because my opponent couldn't create enough Ember. Maybe in a full Archon situation, they're going to have more ways to deal with him and it's less good. But I do like Nerotaurus.
All right, let's talk some payment.
That's where I was headed because this is the worst form of Ember Control. Does it even get Ember Control points? Does it? I don't think so.
It does if you have Customs Office out and you want to play it and you don't have any Ember.
I mean, Customs Office, Tentacus, Anita the Trader.
They're payment.
No, you're not. They are payment, like 100%. But what a terrible form of Ember Control.
So it's not the best, though. It is interesting. Like, I feel like on TCO, it's way better because your opponent will just like artifact. And they're like, wait a second,
where's all my Ember going?
Whereas in person, I feel like after the first one, they'd be like, wait a second, and like,
It's so easy on TCO. Like,
yep.
Because when it's like, because it doesn't ask, it's not like, nobody ever reads the little right hand chat. What I mean?
No.
Nobody ever looks at that and goes, wait a minute, where's all my Ember going?
Not until they realize they have zero Ember.
Don't say that nobody does that.
Yeah, lots of people do.
Do they? I don't.
We don't, because we're all bad.
I haven't looked at a deck list in like a year.
Well, that's because you don't know what any of the cards do, so it doesn't help.
That's not true at all, unfortunately. I don't know. Whenever every Sunday night, I don't care what you're playing. It's not that serious. I mean, I guess, unless you're Dan, I guess maybe it is that serious. I'm not sure. All right, Destroyed Keys. Well, I don't know if any one of these Destroying Keys has ever been successful.
All the time.
Yeah. All the time?
Especially often to great effect.
You know that wild wormhole into the key hammer. That's
my favorite.
That's definitely not lost somebody a game.
I have definitely gone ahead and utilized Groundbreaking Discovery in order to destroy key, and that has some real effect. I even gone ahead and pulled off the Abnormal Break key, even to be able to stall for the turn. Like, they're going for the third key, you don't have it. So you go ahead and can push, take back a key. Fine, here you go. You form the second one.
They're super situational.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, there have been moments, but, like, I feel like... So, your brake key, your key hammer without backup,
they're pointless.
Often not great, right? Because, if you can key hammer lash, yeah, now maybe that's something interesting. Although, you know, the key cost, so actually we didn't get into this key cost, but like, this just made me think of it. So key hammer lash, right? So that can be quite good, right? Because you're increasing key cost by 3,
mm-hmm.
but it can also be sometimes not that great because sometimes you're like, okay, well, I'm going to go into this so I can key hammer lash. And now I'm going to make their keys expensive, but like, maybe they only have like 8 ember, so they don't forge, but then like, you also, to do that little move, might not have advanced your position that much. And then they get another turn, and it's like, well, do I go back to this and lash again to so they pay more? Or do I have to go, or do I need to advance my game and go into a different house? So, like, I do feel like sometimes it's not as effective as it could be. Though, certainly there are plenty of decks where it's just all goodness. But, like, I do feel sometimes like key cost increase can be like a little bit of a trap for yourself, where if you're not careful, you're overcalling a house to be able to use it. And then you slowed yourself down just as much as your opponent.
I think that Groundbreaking Discovery has real play. I don't know about you guys. I
always
think
trigger
is
before
here.
They forged a key.
But that's the whole piece. You can actually let them forge knowing that you're coming back with it right after. So Groundbreaking Discovery, action play. If you control Dr. Proctor, Rooftop Laboratory, and Reckless Experimentation, destroy each card in play, unforge an opponent's key, and purge Groundbreaking Discovery. I don't know. I definitely
have
seen
that. It seems like so much work.
It's really not,
but it's
though.
So much fun when you do it.
I'm sure it is fun, but it's just like, man, is... How many cards do I need? 4?
Mm-hmm.
That seems like a lot to pull off consistently. Because as soon as they know you have the as soon as you see the doctor out, they know you got it.
Yeah, but there are plenty of ways in DT in order to be able to archive cards to be able to do this on one turn. That is not an issue at all. There are ways to be able to cycle back. Key cards too from like I don't know. I think that this is definitely something that should be looked at. It's a lot of fun to be able to pull off. I think even just going for it, I'd picked up a deck just to be able to try it out. And Rooftop Laboratory is the artifact. Each friendly scientist creature enters play ready. Reckless Experimentation with an Amber Pip, this creature gains replay the top card of your deck. I don't know. I think that there's some real power that's there. And you're not giving them amber. So as long as they have a key that's forged, great. You blow up everything that's on the board, which typically DT doesn't have the board presence that others have, or it has a ton of board presence. But depending on which deck you're playing, creature count's usually a little bit lower. And you have a chance to not give them amber for it. I just took your key. Done.
Yeah, that one's good.
It's
hard to rely on without a ton of efficiency, though.
Yes, but...
I'm sorry. What did you say? F is the most important stat in this game?
there you go, Wookie. Teed that up for you.
My ears perked. they went, ooh. No, I think it's one of the cards we pointed out when we were doing our set analysis.
Was
a while ago. So I mean, the idea of it's fun, it just seems like I don't know, I think I said it at the time, it seems like it takes a lot of cards. I don't know, maybe that's just me. All right, here's the best Ember Control, Scaling Ember Control. Who put Burn the Stockpile on Scaling Ember Control? I guess it kind of is.
It counts in DOK.
It count as Scaling Ember Control?
Yep.
Are you serious?
I'm pretty sure, unless I made that up.
I think you made that up.
Well, let me check, because I added it right at the end here, because I was like, wait, that one counts, according to DOK. So let me check.
Like, there's nothing scaling
totally
about it.
This up.
Yeah, while Jasper's looking,
it counts as Scaling Ember Control?
Scaling Ember Control, yep.
I don't know.
It's sort of like red alerts counts as a board wipe, you know.
But there's nothing scaling. Like, it's never going to lose the opponent more than four.
This is true.
So how is it, like, it doesn't, I don't know. That just seems wacky to me.
Yeah, I think it is questionable.
Like, submersive principle. Okay, like, the more you have, the more you lose. TMTP, the high over six you are, the more you lose. Doorstep, I mean, doorstep's the ultimate scaler, right? Just go down to five. Like, so brutal.
Well, but that's I would argue that's an ultimate loss.
It is a loss.
It is scaling, but I mean, in subversive that we were talking about, play, each player loses one amber. If the tide is high, each player loses half their amber instead, rounding down the loss. So that is a symmetrical effect. I don't know. TMP we're going to steal down to six. Doorstep is a loss down to five. Even bring low, it's a capture down to five.
Yeah.
Graft, you're going to, after forging, I'm taking everything else.
Yeah.
Effervescent principle, well, just both of us lose half.
Yep. And then burn, which is just lose four. Everything else is like half. So that's infinite. That, you know, ultimately could be infinite. Same thing with graft, bring low, doorstep, TMTP, subversive principle. Burn the stockpile, I have infinite ember. Okay, lose four of it. You still win.
Yeah, I agree. I question if this one...
That's an interesting call there. That's a very interesting call.
It's interesting. Similar to prevent forging where there's a limited amount, you're scaling. They've really kept that down. I do think that bait and switch I would like to see brought back for scaling. I just don't see it as a major problem.
See, you're seeing it my way now.
Well,
Isn't the show easier when you see it my way?
No,
okay.
No, it's actually not. But I saw bait and switch was fine long time ago. I had no issue with that. But
I think a lot of people did. I still think to this day, a lot of people were like, "What? Why did this get taken?" You know,
I honestly think it's more for the casual crowd. Maybe where their heads
Nobody
were
plays
at.
Plays this game casually. It's life and death, bruh.
You just said you don't even look at deck lists.
Dust pixie, bounce, dust pixie. Key charge for the win.
And no efficiency in that coded deck, so that was all at the bottom. Good job.
I don't know. I've never been like totally like, oh man. Like, you can always play around. I mean, we play around the TMTP. We can play around with bait and switch. I mean, yeah, it totally sucked when it was like, I forged, now I'm stealing four. You know, that was horrible. That it was a feels bad moment.
Yeah,
and I guess it really wasn't that hard to set up.
Well, but even going ahead and playing, you know, read it so that it simply says you can go ahead and steal back and forth. I thought it was perfectly fine, but if you're really worried about the casual crowd, it can't be played the turn after you forge a key. I don't feel the need for that, but if that's really what they're trying to worry about and you're worried about this feels bad moment, then put that stipulation. Don't just go ahead and completely neuter it of, oh, all of a sudden it doesn't have scaling amber control. It just steals one or two.
Oh, and I just remembered we forgot like a crucial key, the original Grump Buggy from Coda.
Iron Obelisk.
Yep. For damage.
I forgot about that card. That was fun.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this list is not exhaustive. Yeah, it's not exhaustive. There's pieces that we've missed. So, yeah. That's where you as the viewers can go ahead and chime in. But I think that anyone listening to this, you can hear key cards from the first six sets. You can see what is important. I know that we talk about the importance of scaling Amber Control. Why do you guys feel that scaling Amber Control is one of those cards that you, one up from this list, would be important to have in your deck? Or do you guys not feel that scaling Amber Control
No, scaling Amber Control, I think, is like, when it comes down to Amber Control, like, it's the most important one, right? So what scaling Amber Control, and this is my theory on scaling Amber Control, right? Like, you see that card in my deck, right? I now kind of hold that over you until I play it. And I get to choose at what time I pop that card. So, you know, at some point in time, like with a TMTP, right? Are you going to go over six knowing there's a TMTP floating around out there? So just the possibility of me having it is holding you back. You don't even know if I have it, but the possibility of me having it, you're afraid to go over six, which is stopping you maybe from doing some of the things you want to do. Maybe you could go to 12 or 14, but because I have the possibility of having that, you're not going to do it. You're probably going to keep around six and kind of mind your P's and Q's until you see it popped, right? And I think with a lot of scaling under control.
Yeah, I agree. And it's interesting, like, that is an effect that only happens with scaling Ember Control. Not even like, hey, I've got a ton of steel or a ton of ways
nobody's,
to make you lose.
Nobody's Ember. Holding creatures because of a board clear.
Right.
Am I wrong on that one, Sheep? You holding creatures because of a board clear?
Maybe a key creature. I don't know.
You know, like in a deck that's it must do something creature-y, but no. No, probably not.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most often not.
But I'm not going to gain more than six Ember if I can absolutely help it knowing there's a TMTP floating around.
Yeah, I might do seven to try to lure it out.
Ooh, you rebel.
Hey, you want one? Yeah. I'll give you one if you take it.
Yeah.
Right?
This is apparently why I take the hits. I will easily go 8-9 and I have no
issue. What? You're crazy.
No.
You're a madman.
It depends.
So here's the other side of this, because MM is well known for not having a tremendous amount of scaling Ember Control. Mm-hmm. So you're telling us, Wookiee, and we've seen this, that you prefer previous sets versus MM. But MM gets quite a bit of love. Yeah,
I love
it. But MM doesn't have the scaling Ember Control.
It doesn't.
So would you rather have your MM deck, or would you rather have your scaling Ember Control with the previous set?
You're making me choose. That's like making me choose children.
Yeah.
Like, what do I do? You know what I mean? Do you choose the boy or the girl? Well, I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, MM is a fantastic set. It doesn't have the scaling Ember Control. In fact, does it have any? It has Effervescent Principle, right?
EP.
It has EP, and it has Bring Low.
Yeah, oh, Bring Low. Right. Bring Low came out in that set, no?
Yep.
No.
Yep.
Did it? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, Bring Low came out in that.
Okay. So, I mean, you have some, you still have some options, you know? Of course, it involves Logos. Why wouldn't it? Because every set has to make Logos the best in that set, if not, you know, top. Now, you know what? I think there's an argument to say that Logos is the best in every single set that's been released to the... Well, maybe not DT. But up until MM, like, Logos was the best house every single set.
Pretty good. I mean, you can make that argument. Like, you can make counter-arguments, but, like...
I don't think you can make counter-arguments.
I mean, there's...
I'm gonna go look.
I mean, Worlds Collide, you could argue Saurian or Stern Alliance or Dis, right?
Sure. But I want to go look at this. All right, let's go to the Vault Tours real quick, right? These are tournament rulings. I know Arcana has it.
Yeah, they have it. Yeah, just search on Vault Tour.
Is there, like, where do I find that again?
I just do Vault Tour in the search bar.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it'll come up.
I will tell you.
Why navigate when you can search?
Right. Yeah. I mean, 100%. All right. So let's look at the Vault Tour winning decks. Right. Captain of Barislaunch has Logos. I don't even know what this is. Salarinius, Logos. Gasoline, Logos. Bahamut, Logos. Ire, Logos. Here's the first one we had in the UK that didn't have Logos, which is. What is with these names? Loribus, first one who doesn't have Logos. Screaming Zima was the our Z Man doesn't have Logos. I mean, now we're getting into Age of Ascent. Oh, some of these might be sealed. Oh, yep, they are. All right, so the first unsealed we have is Honk. Archon Survival. Fraud definitely 100% has Logos. It's a major part of the deck. Snappy Pariah doesn't have Logos. Archon here. Litmus has Logos, and then Gasoline beating Dan in Collinsville has Logos.
Pink I didn't have Logos.
You didn't have Logos? Maybe that's why you didn't win.
You fool.
You fell into my Pink Fraud again winning has Logos. That's a sealed. Light Tasker has Logos. That's sealed. And then Galaxy has Logos. So what, two out of all of those?
Triad, which is Archon, right? So
yeah.
Two.
Well, I just went, it doesn't say Archon. So I went everything that said Archon on it. You know, obviously there was Survival, Solo, Triad, which, so out of his Triad.
One of them had.
Three of them had Logos. Ricardo. Two of them had Logos. Oh, no, just Ricardo. Yeah. Just one had
Ricardo,
Logos.
Ricardo, Yak Street, and King.
Yeah.
Tarantia.
But a majority of the Archon events all had Logos.
Yeah.
Oh, Logos is hella good. Nope,
yeah, no, Logos. Good. There's no doubt in my mind. Logos is the best house.
When you
up to
look
up
at
to
a lot of those,
class.
A lot of those decks outside of Barracks Launch, Logos just provides efficiency to make the other houses fire.
Right, that's fine.
Right,
that's fine. But I mean, do I choose MM? Or scaling Ember Control, back to the original argument, I choose MM with scaling Ember Control, because it is possible. Does that answer your question? Or did I use the workaround?
You've been disqualified.
I've been disqualified. Don't hate on me.
All right, closing thoughts. What do we got?
I don't know. Like, I love Ember Control. You just got to be careful with it. Obviously, there are things that negatively affect your Ember Control in Worlds Collide, and basically, if your deck has Saurian in it, you need to kind of look at your Ember Control, because it can get tricky. Danward?
Nope.
All right. Nope. Drazgor?
I guess we did super get into it, and we won't get into it now. Maybe we'll save it, but it does feel like you need a good amount of Ember Control, or you better produce Ember way faster than your opponent and be able to outrun their big Ember Control. So it feels pretty important.
And Ewok.
This is a race game. I think that's often missed. So either stop your opponent, go ahead and limit them. I think that Steel Hate was a great addition from FFG designers. I think that Steel still continues to be a phenomenal, phenomenal piece, and a lot of people are scared of it. I know you're talking bad about my dinos, but I got to say, Worlds Collide, I love it as a set. Even Lieutenant Gorvenal and Commandeer, like, you can get a lot by placing and having the big Sanctum board in MM to fight. So I'm not a huge fan of Amber Pinatas, but I think at the right time, being able to go ahead and stop your opponent from forging, that's what this is really about, that back and forth battle from Keyforge. So yeah. I think Ember Control is extremely important. I dislike AOA simply in a sealed set because too often it has no Ember Control. And it just comes down to, well, I have nothing to take you off. And that's just sad and depressing. So I like to see some Ember Control.
Yeah. I'm not saying, no, I wasn't saying that I hated on the dinos. Like, there's no doubt Worlds Collide dinos is still pretty top-tier stuff, I in my opinion. Like, they're still really good. Just, they play tricksies on your numbers sometimes, and if you're not paying attention, and you could think your deck's something that it isn't. So, you just gotta pay attention.
I agree with that.
Yep. Alright, that's gonna do for us this week. Dan needs to go to bed. We're well over our time. Holy macaroni. I wasn't even paying attention. Well over our time. So enjoy the extra little bit you got this week. Next week, what I want to do. I want to do two things.
Disruption?
I don't want to do disruption. Well, I kind of do want to do disruption, but in a different way.
Okay.
I want your top 10 Keyforge cards. Standalone. Not well, if I have this and this, now this card's good. Standalone cards.
Just overall, any top set, 10. Any house.
Any set, any house, no matter what it is, top 10. And all I want to build. I know this isn't a deck building game, but I think Dan can contribute here. I want to build the most degenerate deck ever.
Well, but hold on. You just said that you wanted to hear the best cards regardless of what other cards you have, right? So
yes.
Like that's
maybe this is two episodes. Cuz top 10 like, we might all have different opinions.
Not, yeah, top 10 cards that'll be fun. Yeah. And then top 10 combos or something, or
yeah, we can do something like that.
Degenerate ideas. Or...
No. I want to I know Dan has the DOK extension where he could build decks. I want to build the most just absolute degenerate hunk of junk ever that will just make you hate your life so much you quit Keyforge.
So improbable decks?
Yeah, improbable decks. But I want to build one.
10 Heart of the Forests.
that's not 12. There's 12 cards. What are the other two cards?
There are two key abductions. Mavericked.
Mavericked into that house. Perfect. Yes. All right. But that will do it for us this week. Next week, top 10 Keyforge cards ever.
Or we'll something different.
Or something different. We'll talk to you
all. Go check out Patreon. Find us on Discord. We love you guys. Have a good night.
I guess we're also doing something different.
Okay.
Till next week.
Happy Forging, everyone.